Let's start. So I told you I'll explain the seventh problem today, right? So there is a charge Q, right, that is distributed over three concentric spherical shells of radii A, B, C, such that their surface charge densities are equal to one another. Now the question is, the potential at a point at a distance R from their common center, where R is less than A, is how much? Okay, you try to draw the diagram. Tell me what you think will be the answer. You guys first try. I'll explain the concept. So, okay, this is actually a very good question. Can you guys tell me what are you able to understand? What formula are we supposed to use? If I put a question like this, what will you say? So, our work is to find the total potential. So, potential is going to be a scalar quantity. That's what I understand. Right? So, what comes to your mind? Tell me. So, there is a total charge of Q, which has to be distributed among how many spheres? Three concentric spherical shells. Okay, let me draw them. One, two, and three. Okay, three concentric spherical shells of how much of radii? A, B, and C. Correct? Now, where is the point that is considered? The point is considered somewhere over here. That's what they told, no? The point is at a distance R from the common center, okay, which is less than A. At this point, our interest of study is to find out what is the total potential. So, how do we proceed with the given information? So there is some other important point that is given. What is it?
Surface charge density is equal.
Yes. So when you talk about a spherical shell, we talk about the surface charge density. So A, B, C, if I name them as A, B, C, what is the surface density of A? It is QA divided by 4 pi A square. What is sigma B? It is QB divided by 4 pi B square. Actually, wait. Sigma C is how much? Q divided by 4 pi C square. Correct? Does this make sense?
Yes, sir.
Actually, no. Because what mistake did I do?
Sir, the charge Q is distributed.
Yes, the charge Q is distributed in a logical Yoshipara. See, if sigma A is Q by something, so sigma is inversely proportional to A square. So if sigma A is equal to sigma B is equal to sigma C, where all the charges are equal, then it is possible only when A is equal to B is equal to C. Correct? That's not happening. It is QA, QB, QC. Very careful. So QA plus QB plus QC is equal to the total charge. So how do we find QA? That is sigma into 4 pi A square plus sigma. Sigma A is sigma, sigma B is sigma, there is also sigma. Sigma into 4 pi B square plus sigma into 4 pi C square is equal to Q. So sigma is how much? Q divided by 4 pi into A square plus B square plus C square. Correct? Now with this, so let me call this as equation number one. The reason why I found is, I made sigma in terms of the known parameters. What are the known parameters that I have? Charge, A, B, C, all are known parameters. So I'm safe. Next, what is the objective of this question? We need to find the potential at point P. So how do I find the potential at point P? Now, here comes an important point. So if there is a spherical shell, now we need to recollect the concepts. Okay, guys, listen, I'll ask you some questions, answer them. If I talk about a spherical shell, listen to my question carefully. When I give charge to it, where will it be distributed? It is for a spherical shell, where is the charge distributed? On the surface or is it within the volume?
On the surface.
On the surface. So spherical shell is a conductor. Now my question is, what is the electric field inside a spherical shell? I'm trying to cover two concepts. E is zero. Then what is V equal to?
Zero.
V is not zero. The reason I asked is, I know you'll get confused here. E is equal to minus dV by dr. Correct? When electric field is zero inside, derivative it's of constant. What function? It should be a constant. What that constant is, that's the answer. That's the question. Q divided by 4 pi epsilon naught, whatever is the radius that you need to write. Okay. So what I'm trying to say is, V inside a spherical shell is equal to V surface, but V outside is equal to Q divided by 4 pi epsilon naught R, where R is the distance from the center. Are you guys able to understand this? Okay, what is V inside is equal to V surface. That is Q, that is a charge that is there on the surface, divided by 4 pi epsilon naught into the radius of that particular spherical shell. Now tell me, what will be the answer for VP here? Is it not the potential due to A plus potential due to B plus potential due to C? So for A, QA will be here, QB will be here, QC will be here, correct? So what is the value of VA, guys? According to the logic that I explained, if anybody wants to see, you can have a look at it. If there is any doubt, get it clarified. So tell me, what will be the answer here? It will be QA divided by 4 pi epsilon naught.
A.
A plus QB divided by 4 pi epsilon naught.
B.
How much is it? Plus QC divided by 4 pi epsilon naught C. Okay. Now, what is going to be the total potential? VP will be equal to QA by 4 pi epsilon naught A plus, I'm writing it again, by 4 pi epsilon naught B plus QC divided by 4 pi epsilon naught C. Now, I have an important question. What is the value of QA? Is QA not equal to sigma into 4 pi A square? Correct. QA one is sigma into 4 pi A square only, right? But sigma is how much? Q divided by 4 pi into A square plus B square plus C square into 4 pi A square. 4 pi gone. So A square divided by A square plus B square plus C square into the total charge Q is equal to QA. Then what about QB? It will be B square divided by A square plus B square plus C square into Q. QC will be how much? C square divided by A square plus B square plus C square into how much? Into Q. Now substitute all the values, then VP will be how much? Is it not A plus B plus C divided by A square plus B square plus C square times Q, the whole multiplied with 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught. You take LCM and add them. That is what you're going to get. Am I clear with this? So is there an option? Q Q into A plus B plus C by 4 pi epsilon naught option B. Correct, Ada? Yeah. Guys, are you clear? Now, I'm going to change the question. Find the value of the total potential at point P, which is at a distance R, which is greater than B and less than C. Pannunga. The same condition. Okay, same condition, but I want to know what is the potential at this point. You need not simplify it. Just tell me the expression that is more than sufficient. I want to understand whether you have got the concept. Who can tell me? Who can tell me, da?
Sir, is it the potential at C due to C?
No, that you have to tell me, no? Which is greater than B. So there is a point P here, which is at a distance R. Now you tell me. Same condition, nothing I'm changing. Just tell me the expression, that's enough. Q A divided by, I gave you a formula, like V outside, V inside, otherwise you calculate, no? So you look at individual spheres. So, how many spherical shells are there? There are 3 spherical shells. So, due to each spherical shell, write down the potential. QA divided by how much? 4 pi epsilon naught into plus QB divided by 4 pi epsilon naught plus QC divided by 4 pi epsilon naught. I only need to decide what should be written beside that 4 pi epsilon naught. So with respect to QA, what should I write? 4 pi epsilon naught. Guys, with respect to A, is it outside or inside?
Outside.
Outside na penna. Whatever is the distance from the center to the point which is outside, write that value. So, what should I put there? QA divided by 4 pi epsilon naught?
R.
Complete. That's it. With respect to B?
R.
That's it. With respect to C?
C.
That's it. Understood? So, next time onwards, you need not sit and do whole thing. You just write it like this. You're going to get the answer in one step. Only thing is, you need to find out what is this QA, QB and QC. For that, you have no other option. Guys, am I clear? This is an interesting and an important problem. This is how a Van de Graaff generator actually works, which is not there in your syllabus. Generator. Okay. That's how it works. It works on this principle only. Okay, next. I think there is some other problem I told, I'll explain it today. Okay, we'll do 2 more problems, then we'll proceed to capacitors. Okay. We'll do the 8th one now. A uniformly charged ring of radius 3a and a total charge q is placed in xy plane centered at origin. A point charge q moving towards the ring along the z-axis has a speed of v at z is equal to 4a. The minimum value of v such that it crosses the origin is how much? So how do we proceed? So there is a ring like this. Okay. So uniformly charged ring has a radius of 3a and a total charge of q is placed in the xy plane centered at the origin. This is the origin. A point charge q moving towards the ring along the z-axis has a speed of z is equal to 4a. Sorry, at a distance z is equal to 4a. The speed here is v. What should be the minimum value of v so that it is able to cross the origin? So how do we solve this? How do you solve this, sir? Guys, how do we proceed? So wherever velocity comes, what did I say? So wherever velocity comes, what energy can you think of?
Kinetic energy.
Yes. So here, the kinetic energy should be minimum enough so that it is able to travel where? So observe, this is also having a charge q. So the ring is also having a positive charge. This is also having a positive charge. So when it is trying to travel towards the origin, what is it going to experience? It's going to experience a repulsive force. There needs to be some work that is done to overcome this repulsive force. And that is what gets converted into the potential energy, right? So can I frame a statement like this? The kinetic energy should be greater than or at the max equal to the change in potential energy that is taking place between the points P and O. P and O, well, I have to write it as final minus initial, right? U O minus U P. Does this make sense? So half mv square must be greater than or equal to U naught minus UP. How do I calculate this U naught minus UP? One thing that is missing the question is, did they give mass? But the answer has mass. Let's assume that it has mass. MV square greater than or equal to U naught is, can I write it as Q into V naught minus VP? Does this make sense? Now the question is, what is the value of V naught? And what is the value of VP? Since I framed the equation, now my only task is to ensure to find what is V naught and VP. How do I do that? What is going to be the potential due to the charge on the ring at point P? How much, sir? So, the advantage whenever you have a ring in your hand is, it can be treated like a point mass, right? So, if suppose, listen, there is actually a formula. If this point is, just let me show it to you what formula it is. Not given here, but I'll explain it. See, when there is a point charge q here, okay, if this distance is x and this distance is r, then the potential due to the ring at point P is given by kq divided by root of r square plus x square. Okay, please make a note of this. So it is kq divided by root of r square plus x square, where x is the distance from the center to the point where you are trying to calculate the field. Now apply all these formula and tell me what is the value of V naught.
Kq by root over 3a square plus 4a square.
Kq divided by root of 9a square plus 4a square, 16a square. That is kq divided by 5a, correct? Similarly, this is at point P. What is at point O? Kq divided by 3a, because that's the radius. Right? Now, half mv square should be greater than or equal to q into v naught minus vp, that is kq divided by 3a minus kq divided by 5a. So how much will that be, guys? Half mv square greater than or equal to kq square in divided by 15a square into 2a. This and this will get cancelled. I hope it is right. So mv square is greater than or equal to 4kq square divided by 15a. M will come this side. So what is the answer? V should be greater than or equal to root of 4kq square divided by 15m into a. Is there an option like this stuff? So 4kq square by 15m into a. 4, now you can write it as 2 into 2. Is this? So last option is right. Okay. Now, one point I would like to explain is, how did we get this value? Anybody? How did we actually get this value?
Sir, are we considering a small charge dq and then measuring it?
That's what, yes, exactly. You are taking dq, right? Due to dq, if there is a test charge q naught here, the answer will be root of r square plus x square. So, what is the potential energy between this point charge and the test charge that is going to exist? Is it not kq naught into dq divided by root of r square plus x square? So what will be the value of total charge? Total charge will be equal to kq naught divided by root of r square plus x square into integral of dq, because no other variable is there. So integral of dq is how much? Q into q naught divided by root of r square plus x square. This is the potential energy. So what is the formula for potential? It is the amount of potential energy by Q naught. That will be KQ divided by root of R square. Chariya, that's how we have got. If you still have a doubt of how we got it. Does this make sense?
Yes.
Right. Please make a note of it. Shall I move to the next one? We'll do one last problem and then we'll move on to the next topic. So I want you all to try the 10th one. It is something similar to how I explained with respect to a ring. A charge Q is uniformly distributed over a long rod AB of length L as shown in the figure. The electric potential at the point O lying at a distance L from the end A is how much? how to proceed? So whenever you see a linear rod, what comes to your mind first?
Linear first charge define. Density.
So linear charge density is how much? Q divided by L. Let that be equation number one. So in that, what we are supposed to do? Consider
small element.
Small element whose charge is dQ, whose thickness is dx, and at a distance x from one of the ends. Correct?
Yes, sir.
So here, how many variables do you have? dQ and x. These are the two variables. So can I write lambda is equal to dQ by dx, which implies dQ is equal to Q by L into dx. Second. Now tell me, due to this dQ, what is going to be the potential at point O? Due to dQ, potential at O is how much? K dQ. See, dQ, it is point charge. So whatever formula is applicable for point charge, apply it. So according to this problem, tell me that KQ divided by L plus X. Correct? So this is how much? This is dV, which implies dV is equal to K divided by L plus X into Q by L into dx. Correct? If you tell me what is the value of V, integral of what all will come out of integral? KQ by L will come out of integral. Dx divided by L plus X is there. Now, what is the variable? X is the variable. So, X is varying from where to where? If you take this side as 0, this side will be L. Correct? So, what should be the limit? 0 to L. So, KQ divided by L into ln of L plus X from where to where? 0 to L. So it will be KQ divided by L into ln 2L minus ln L. So how much is it? KQ divided by L into ln 2. Correct? That is Q divided by 4 pi epsilon naught L into. Everyone is clear? So shall we proceed to capacitors? Other yes, problems, sir. I hope you can handle it. Gauss theorem and spherical. The spherical shell also indirectly I've taught you, right? You can actually go through it and you people can try it. So for example, this kind of a problem, you can try it. Like how I explained it, no, today. Electric dipole, you know. Yes, capacitors is what we are going to do. Okay, so capacitors, you people know the basics, right? So when you talk about a parallel plane, so what basically what does a capacitance mean? Capacitance mathematically means the amount of charge per unit potential, Q by VR. So for a parallel plate capacitor, C is how much? It is epsilon naught A divided by D, okay, when it is in the air or vacuum. Correct? Next. When a dielectric is placed, what will happen? When a dielectric of is placed, which is of thickness T, solanda, C is equal to epsilon naught A divided by D minus T plus T by kappa. If n dielectrics are placed of thickness how much? T1, T2, so on till Tn, and dielectric constants of kappa 1, kappa 2, so on till kappa n. Then how much is the capacitance? It is epsilon naught A divided by D minus T1, D minus T1, minus T2, minus T3, so on till minus Tn, plus T1 by kappa 1, plus T2 by kappa 2, plus so on till Tn by kappa n. So all these things I have shown you in CBSE also. I have derived and shown, right? Now, the next question is, capacitors in series. So when we say capacitors are in series, what comes to your mind? Charges?
Same.
Same. That is constant. Correct? So equivalent, 1 by C equivalent will be equal to 1 by C1 plus 1 by C2 plus so on till 1 by Cn. What about capacitors in parallel? V is constant. So C equivalent will be equal to C1 plus C2 plus so on till C. Right. So based on these formulae only, we are going to solve the problems from capacitors. So let me know if there is any doubt, or we can proceed with the problems itself. Shall I start?
Sure.
Yeah. Now listen. So let's try the first one. So in the given circuit, the charge on the 4 microfarad capacitor is how much? So how do we proceed? So before I find the charge on it, what is our first duty? We need to find its equivalent capacitance. Only then I will be able to find out what is the potential across this. Right? How do I proceed, guys? Tell me. How do we proceed? Huh?
Sir, so first equivalent capacitance contributing.
How much is that? C equivalent is how much?
Sir, first this 1 five, and 5 are in parallel, so now 6.
6 microfarad, okay. 6 so and 4 are series, in series.
So now it's 2.4.
Okay. It's 2.4 microfarad.
Then 5.4, sir.
Then
5.4. So C equivalent is 5.4 microfarad. Okay. Now, what is going to be the net charge that is going to come out? Net charge out of the circuit will be C equivalent into the total potential difference, right? So, if you have to apply this formula, okay, a thumb rule. If you have to apply this Q is equal to CV formula, you need to ensure there is only one battery. Okay. So, what is the value of C equivalent? 5.4 into 10 power minus 6 into V is 10. So it will be 5.4 into 10 power minus 5 coulomb. Correct? So out of this 5.4 into 10 power minus 5 coulomb, how much is carried by the 3 microfarad capacitor? Charge through the 3 microfarad capacitor is how much? Is it not 3 into 10 power minus 6 into 10? So is it not 3 into 10 power minus 5? 3 into 10 power minus 5 coulomb. So, what is going to be the charge across this 4 microfarad? It is 5.4 minus 3 into 10 power minus 5. Correct? That is 2.4 into 10 power minus 5 coulomb. So, 24 into 10 power minus 6 coulomb. So, how much is answer? 24 microcoulomb. Correct? you understood how I told it as 5.4 minus 3 because the charge across the 4 microfarad will be the same as the equivalent 2.4 microfarad. That is how I could find. So it should be subtracted from the total only. Right? Let's move on to the next one.
Sir, across the 1 microfarad, we have to
Across 1 microfarad, now what you suppose you want this to be solved. Okay, let's extend the question. Suppose they ask across the 1 microfarad capacitor, tell me what will you do? You will be able to calculate the charge here only if you know what is the potential difference here. So here it is 10, correct? Between point A and B it is 10. Between point C and between point C and D also it is 10. So how much will be the potential difference here then? Across C and E will work. So how do you calculate the potential difference across C and E? Is it not the charge across the 4 microfarad divided by the capacitance of it? Q is equal to CV. So charge across it is 24 into 10 power minus 6 divided by capacitance. 4 into 10 power minus 6. Correct? So how much is it? It is 6 volt. Puridada? So out of 10 volt, 6 volt is dropped here. So how much is the remaining here?
4 volts and they will go for that combination.
So 4 will be there for 1. So what will be the answer?
So 1 into 4, so 4 micro coulomb.
That's the answer. Got it?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Okay. Shall I move on to the next one? Yes. I think this should be an interesting problem. Let's see. So second one. Let's see. Two identical parallel plate capacitors of capacitance C each have plates of area A separated by distance D. The space between the plates of the two capacitors is filled with three dielectrics of equal thickness and dielectric constants K1, K2 and K3. The first capacitor is filled as shown in figure 1 and the second one is filled as shown in figure 2. Sorry. If these two modified capacitors are charged by the same potential difference V, the ratio of the energy stored in two would be how much? The ratio of the energy stored in the two. Abdina, okay. E1 by E2 is what they're asking. That's what the options say, right? Okay. E1 by E2 is how much? E1 refers to the capacitor 1 and E2 refers to the energy of capacitor 2. Okay, let's start solving it. Each have plates C. So one ambiguity I'm able to see here is, which one should I take as parallel plate? Okay. I'm going with this thing, okay? The one which is dark is considered to be the plate. Now, across the capacitor, where will you connect the potential difference? The potential source will be connected across the plates. Correct? This point is clear to us. Now tell me, with respect to the first capacitor, okay, with respect to the first capacitor, K1, K2 and K3 are the three dielectrics that are inserted and how are they placed with respect to each other?
Series.
Yes, they are in series. Then what about second one? They are in parallel. I hope you're able to understand why I'm saying it is parallel, because here the potential, if it is plus and here it is minus. Here also same potential, plus minus, plus minus, plus minus. They will have the same value of the potential difference. For example, here it is 5 volt and here it is 0. Here it will be 5, here also 5, here also 5, because it's the same plate. So yeah. Now, how do I calculate the energy in one? Can I say the energy in one is equal to half into C equivalent into V square? Half C V square then, huh? So energy across two is also half C equivalent dash into V square because they are connected to the same potential difference. And something else is also same. In the two identical parallel plate capacitors, both have the same capacitance. Okay, now how do we proceed? Now you tell me, guys. So how do we proceed? So how do I calculate if I take this as the part A, part B, part C? What is the capacitance of part A? Epsilon naught A divided by Yeah, something is missing here. What is it? Separated by distance d. I don't know how much is this distance. Now, how do I solve? Did they give anything? Actually, there is a lot of data missing. Separated by distance d. Okay, if I take the total distance to be d, are these three of the equal width? That point is not given. No.
Sir, it's given as equal thickness.
Ningamma. Oh, no, dielectrics sir. Of equal. Okay. Yeah, I got it. Thank you. So it should be d by 3 into what is going to be the capacitance of into K1. So CBN, it will be epsilon naught, the same area of cross section divided by d by 3 into K2. CC will be epsilon naught A divided by d by 3 into K3. Okay. Now, since these three are in series, what should I do to them? So what will be the equivalent capacitance? 1 by C equivalent will be equal to 1 by CA plus 1 by CB plus 1 by CC. So 1 by C equivalent will be how much? D by 3 divided by epsilon naught A is common into 1 by K1 plus 1 by K2 plus 1 by K3. Correct? So 1 by C equivalent is equal to D by 3 epsilon naught A into K2 K3 plus K1 K3 plus K1 K2 the whole divided by K1 K2 K3 and C equivalent will be how much? K1 K2 K3 divided by K1 K2 plus K2 K3 plus K3 K1 multiplied with how much? Into 3A divided by D. Let this be equation number 1. In a similar context, can you guys tell me what is going to be the capacitance here? So, when they are in series, what got divided into equal parts?
The area of cross sections.
And when they were in series, ra?
Oh, series. Series, na thickness.
Thickness got divided. Now, when they are in parallel, what will happen?
Parallel area of cross section.
Area of cross section will become 3. And its equivalent capacitance will be C1 plus C2 plus C3. Calculate that and tell me fast. So what is C1 here? It will be K1 times epsilon naught A by 3 divided by D, correct? C2 and the epsilon naught, K2 times epsilon naught A by 3 divided by D. C3 will be K3 times epsilon naught A by 3 divided by D. So what will be the C equivalent value? C1 plus C2 plus C3. So epsilon naught A by 3D into K1 plus K2 plus K3. Correct? So E1 by E2 is nothing but C equivalent by C equivalent dash. Idha C equivalent dash. So epsilon naught A by 3D. I forgot epsilon naught A. So epsilon naught A 3 times divided by D into K1, K2, K3 divided by K1, K2 plus K2, K3 plus K3, K1. The whole divided by C equivalent dash is epsilon naught A divided by 3D into K1 plus K2 plus K3. So epsilon naught A divided by D, epsilon naught A divided by D will get cancelled. 3 will go to the numerator. 9 into K1, K2, K3 divided by K1, K2 plus K2, K3 plus K3, K1 into 1 divided by K1 plus K2 plus K3. Let's check if there is an option. 9 K1, K2, K3, this should be the option. Correct? But I hope everyone is clear with the problem.
Yes, sir.
Actually, the diagram should have been more clear. You know, if at all the vertical ones are taken as the plates, no, whole story will change. You will get something else. That 9 will come in the denominator. All things will change. Okay. But I'm just concerned about the concept. This is the answer. Okay. Next. Let's do this. So there is a simple pendulum. There is a simple pendulum of length L that is placed between the plates of a parallel plate capacitor having an electric field E as shown in the figure. Its bob has a mass M and charge Q. The time period of the pendulum is given by what? See, time period in it actually. Time period is 2 pi root of L by G. Correct? That's the time period of a pendulum. But whereas, if there is any other field other than the gravitational field also existing, then you call it as G effective. To be more specific, you call it as acceleration effective. Okay. Now tell me logically, there is a simple pendulum of length L, electric field E. So what is the direction of electric field it is going to be in this? So they have already given, sorry. It is from the positive to the negative plate. Its bob has a mass M and charge Q. I'm assuming charge to be positive. Then how is this pendulum going to be suspended? It will be like this. So Mg is in this direction. QE is in this direction. So what is going to be the value of effective gravity? Is this not M into G effective or M into A effective rather? I can be more specific about. Correct? So what will be the value of A effective multiplied with M? That will be root of M square G square plus Q square E square. So what will be the value of A effective? That will be, if I take out M, root of G square plus Q square E square divided by M square. So time period another 2 pi root of L divided by square root of G square plus Q square E square divided by M square. Is there an option? Clear? I hope you understood what I did here. Guys, are you clear with this step? I forgot to ask. What did I do?
Magnitude.
I calculated using what law of vectors?
Parallelogram.
Yeah, parallelogram. Okay. Shall I move on to the next one? 2019. So this is actually a CBSE level problem. Figure shows charge Q versus voltage V. Graph for series and parallel combination of the two given capacitors. The capacitances are So charge and volt are given. Q is equal to CV. They're asking capacitance. So C is equal to Q by V. So if you look at it mathematically, Q is on Y axis. V is on X axis. So Y divided by X is what? It's the slope. Right? So for us to find the slope, we will take the coordinates. So what are the coordinates of this point? 10, 80. This point. 10, 500. So, capacitance of A, another 500 minus 0 divided by 10, cancel, 50. Capacitance of B is 80 divided by 10, 8. 80 is another. There is no option. Oh, sorry. I read the question wrong. Can someone tell me what mistake did I do?
So slope is X by Y.
No. Y by X is right. Mathematically, there is no mistake that I did.
Sir, it's given separately for series and parallel.
They told series and parallel. What I thought is this is capacitor A and capacitor B. No. That's not the thing. Okay. So, graph for series and parallel combination is what is shown here. So, there are a lot of hidden information is there in this. So, when I talk about the equivalent capacitance, if I talk about the equivalent capacitance of series and parallel, which one is more?
Parallel.
So parallel is more. So A is a graph and B is a graph, which is a relation between Q and P. So if I find the slope of A, that is going to give me some capacitance. It will give me an equivalent capacitance. Slope of B will also give me C equivalent. Now tell me, which C equivalent belongs to series and which one belongs to parallel? So, slope of series is less than slope of parallel. Can I write it like that? Because with respect to a Q, see, there are two types of graph that they will give you, okay? Sometimes what they can do is they can give you Q here and V here. At that time, what will happen? Capacitance is a reciprocal of slope. So be careful, okay? The same thing is applicable to Ohm's law also. So if they give V on Y axis and Q on X axis, then the reciprocal of the slope is what is capacitance. Whereas Q on Y axis and V on X axis, it is the slope that is the capacitance. So slope means nothing but tan theta. Tan is an increasing function. So more is the angle, more will be the slope. So slope of series is greater than slope of parallel. Now you tell me, which one belongs to series? CB is less than CA. Correct? So what is CB? CB is what is 8. How did I get that 8? 80 divided by 10. Slope. Correct? So, but according to the formula, if I take the two capacitors' capacitance to be C1 and C2, then what will be the series combination one's capacitance? C1, C2 divided by C1 plus C2 is what is 8? Correct? Are you able to understand what I'm trying to say? Similarly, CA will be how much? What is the slope of this line? It is 50. 50 microfarad is equal to how much? C1 plus C2. If there is any doubt, get it clarified. Okay. Then I assume things are clear. So C1 plus C2 substituted here. C1, C2 will be 40. Sorry, 400. C1, C2 will be 400. So C1 plus C2 is 50 means, how do I find C1 minus C2? C1 minus C2 is square root of C1 plus C2 the whole square minus 4C1 C2. So root of 2500 minus 4 into 400. How much is that? 2500 under a root, that will be 30. So C1 minus C2 is, so C1 plus C2 is 50. C1 minus C2 is 30. So 2C1 is how much? 80. So C1 will be 40 microfarad. And C2 will be 10 microfarad. Is there an option like that? 40 and 10. Option D. So this is actually a mathematics problem. Application of straight lines or slope. Right? We'll do another problem. Let's do this. The parallel combination of two air-filled parallel plate capacitors of capacitance C and NC is connected to a battery. The parallel combination of two air-filled C and NC is connected to a battery of potential difference V. Okay. When the capacitors are fully charged, the battery is removed. And after that, a dielectric material of dielectric constant K is placed between the plates of the first capacitor. Now, then they are fully charged. Okay. Then they are fully charged. There is a dielectric material of constant K that is inserted completely here. The new potential difference of the combined system will be. So, what is the value of V dash? Okay, so how do we proceed? So you need to recollect one concept. You guys remember there is an important concept. There is a table that I would have given in CBSE. Another thing. Dielectric with battery connected and dielectric without battery. Do you guys remember that? So when a dielectric is inserted with battery and without battery, what will happen to the parameters? Capacitance will become K times epsilon naught A by D. Here also the capacitance will become K times epsilon naught A by D. What will happen to the charge? So charge here remains same. Your charge changes. What will happen to the potential difference? V remains same when battery is connected. That's logically, right? When battery is connected, the potential difference is still going to be the same. Here, V decreases. Okay. So remaining parameters you can calculate. Now you have to read one important point in the question. When the capacitors are fully charged, the battery is removed. After that, a dielectric material is inserted. So dielectric was not inserted when the battery was connected itself. So what parameter will remain constant? Dielectric without battery. If you take it like a matrix, what remains constant? The charge remains constant. So if I'm able to calculate the charge here, if I call it as Q dash, then Q and Q dash are numerically the same values. So to calculate the final potential V dash in terms of V, I'm going to calculate Q in terms of C, NC, and V. How do I calculate the total charge? C and NC are connected in parallel. So case one, C equivalent is how much? 1 plus N into C. Q will be how much? C equivalent into V. That is 1 plus N into CV. Let this be equation number one. Case two. What is C equivalent? So here it is NC. Here it is KC. It will be K plus N into C. So Q dash will be how much? K plus N into C into V dash. That is 2. Q is equal to Q dash, which implies 1 plus N into CV is equal to K plus N into CV dash. C gets cancelled. So V dash is equal to 1 plus N into V divided by K plus N.
Sir?
Tell me.
Sir, I didn't understand the tabular column.
That's there, no? I gave it in CBSC. So, when you talk about a dielectric being inserted between the plates of a capacitor, okay, listen to this carefully. When you have a capacitor filled with air medium, when you have a capacitor with dielectric filled. So, when you fill with the dielectric, there are two things. When you're filling the dielectric, you can either connect the battery and do it, or you can disconnect the battery and do it. So when you connect the battery and do, or whether you disconnect the battery and do, the capacitance of the new, the capacitance with dielectric will increase. By what factor? By a factor of kappa. That point is clear? Okay. So when battery is still connected, the potential difference that is being supplied by the battery will still be the same. Correct? So V will remain the same with battery connected. So if a logic enna, Q is equal.
Students, are you able to hear me?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay. My device also lost charge. Okay. So I'll just explain it. Please make a note. Did you guys make a note of that with battery and without battery?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So you understood what will happen. The capacitance will increase. I hope that point is clear. With irrespective of whether the battery is connected or disconnected, the capacitance of the capacitor, as soon as the dielectric is inserted, will increase. That point is clear, right? Now, what will happen to the potential difference when the battery is still connected? Will it remain the same or will it decrease? Suppose, let's say your mobile is charged to the 100%. Okay, your mobile has 100% charge. You still connect it to the charger. Will there be a potential drop? It will still remain at 100%, right? When it is fully charged. I'm using the same logic. So, adanala battery. 1 minute. I got my device back. I'll write and show. Guys, sorry, my device is not writing. No problem. Wait, I'll explain this problem alone and let's end the session. See, with battery you are able to see now what is happening. Ipa paranga. V remains the same. So what will happen to Q? What is the formula for Q? Q is equal to
CV.
Ma. So C is K times epsilon naught AD with battery. Correct. Tabular column bar. I'm not able to write here, so concentrate. C is K times epsilon naught A by D and B remains the same. So when you multiply both, what will happen to the charge? It will become same. K times charge will not be same per first column. Charge will increase by what factor?
K times.
It will increase K times because originally what was the capacitance? Epsilon naught A by D then. When that is multiplied with potential, now it has become K times. After what?
Yes,
after, okay, up increase actually. So look at the same thing without battery. Without battery, I told you, capacitor on the independent device. Okay. It's like you go and buy a battery from a shop, its potential difference is 5 volt, 5 volt. So without a battery, now it is K times, its capacitance in both the cases same. I hope that point is clear.
Yes, sir.
Now, when the battery is disconnected, what will happen to the potential? There will be a drop.
because you have removed the battery, there will be a potential drop. By what factor? Potential will drop by a factor of kappa times. Then what will happen to the charge? Multiply both and see. K times epsilon naught A by D into V by K.
Remains the same. Yes, sir, I understand.
That is the reason I wrote remains the same. Correct? So I hope everybody got this, even if you have forgotten. Right? See, I'm not able to write. My devices, everything have stopped functioning. I'll stop with this. Okay? So next class, we'll continue with few more problems. Then we'll go to current electricity. Till then, you practice, and if you have any doubts, you can approach me. Okay? I'll see you guys in the next class.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.